opening hymn, please. Pray together in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The grace and peace of God our Father, the love of Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with each of you. I'm Father Eugene McKinnon. I don't really belong here, but I'm glad I'm here today. I'm from one of the parishes over the other side of town. I invite you to be seated, and we'll begin our Mass with symbols of Tony's faith and our faith too, that through death God calls us to eternal life. Now I'm playing on a different ground today, so I've got to turn around and find out where the Easter candle is. It's way back there. I think Ricky's going to come up and help me light the Easter candle. You can take that there. Each year this candle is blessed, and it is a symbol of new life and resurrection that Tony shares in and that we all one day hope to share in. Thank you. And I invite now Siobhan and Brett to come forward. Somebody will have to lift the flowers. On the day of his baptism, Tony put on Christ. In the day of Christ's coming, may he be clothed in glory. And even though he was a great Irishman, we place traditional Australian flowers and plants as a sign of freshness and new life. Good thing I'm fit. I've got to take a run up to the holy water. We bless Tony's coffin with holy water, a of which St. Paul writes, all of us who were baptised into Christ Jesus were baptised into his death. And we believe that just as Jesus died and rose again, Tony now shares the fullness of the resurrection. And Patty and Marie, if you'd like to come forward now and share the eulogy, please.
Dad's life was not about achievements, although he had plenty of those, or about places he'd been to, and he'd been to many. It was about the people around him and how he's able to easily connect to almost anyone in his life. He loved the company of his family and friends. He gave us all of his attention, and depending on the situation, would offer support, lend an ear, have a laugh, or do all of those things. Dad was born in Ireland in 1935. He had three sisters and four brothers, and he adored them all. When Dad was young, Ireland was quite poor and luxuries were rare. Dad's sister Joan told the story that in those days, when someone died, the person would always be waked at home. And people would put some black lace on the front door, letting people know that there had been a death in the family. For a wake, the family would always put their best foot forward and provide some refreshments for sympathisers, whiskey for men, tea for the ladies, lemonade for children, and there'd usually be cake and sandwiches for everyone. Tony, always the opportunist, quickly realised that wakes were a reliable source of treats, and he made sure to never to miss an opportunity to sympathise. Jones said that they would be heading home from school and Tony would spot the black lace and make a beeline for the house, while the rest of them would be too shy and embarrassed to go in. They also had to wait for Tony to come back out, as there would be war if they arrived home without him. In terms of Dad's formal education, it's safe to say that he and the Irish education system were not the best of friends. In fact, Dad had been sent off to boarding school by the age of seven in an effort to keep him on the straight and narrow. It didn't work. Although not a fan of the traditional education system, he was a true thinker. He was deeply reflective on politics and society and genuinely concerned about the state of things here in Australia and overseas throughout his life. Dad later met our mother while she was travelling in England, and they eventually moved to Australia. It was a huge opportunity for Dad, but was also a gamble. He was the only one of his siblings who had left, and he had to work extremely hard to build a life that we all enjoyed.
In 1972, Mum and Dad had their first child, Emma. They went on to have four more. I'm not sure Dad ever had a particular desire to have so many kids, but being a dad turned out to be something he excelled at. Throughout our lives, Dad has been a constant and we owe him everything. When we were young, he was warm and fun, and there was always a lot going on around the place. By the time we'd grown into adults, Dad had managed to develop a close relationship with all of the kids. Not easy, given that there are five of us and we are all very different. He embraced his son-in-law, Brett, and his daughter-in-law, Alicia, like they were his own. Dad also showed a loving interest in all of his grandchildren. He watched the boys play footy at Springbank on a Saturday morning and took a keen interest in their education. Dad spent hours with Shaki, also known as Trixie, talking and playing. And although there was nearly 80 years difference in their age, he connected with her in a way that only he could. I am so grateful for the patience and love he put into helping raise her. Dad also adored spending time with little Bodhi last Easter. I am continually blown away by the close relationship Dad had with many of his nieces and nephews. Some had moved out to Australia to build their new life here, and he would travel to see them. Siobhan in Adelaide, Grania in Melbourne, and Gillian in Brisbane. And they would often come to Buninyong to visit him. There was a lot of good food and wine involved in these visits, as well as trips to art galleries and anything else of interest. Dad was also close with his nephew Rob and Rob's beautiful wife Mairead, who live in Ireland. We often joke that Rob was a second son to Dad. Dad was always very young in himself, and he had a wonderful outlook on life. but this was never more evident than when he was hanging out with Robin Marade. Over his life, he taught all of us the importance of hard work, but more than this, he showed us the importance of being grateful in our lives. He was grateful for the big things like family and friends, but he was also grateful and content with the smaller things like a good red wine, good conversation, and a good book.
When we were growing up, Dad used to frequent the Buninyong pub every Friday night. He used to say he was off to the font of knowledge. He had a group of wonderful friends back then, many of whom proved to be lifelong friends: Peter Powers, Taffy, John Freeman, and many more. Dad was also heavily involved with the Buninyong community more generally. He owned and ran the Buninyong Post Office for 25 years. He was also involved with organising the Buninyong Gold King Festival for many years. The post office was an interesting place. Dad managed to turn what might have been otherwise a fairly dull job into an exciting life. No doubt it helped that he worked with people like Ricky Williams, who kept things fun, and that the place was always filled with an assortment of interesting Buninyong characters. Some recently told me that the atmosphere at the Buninyong post office at times was closer to a pub than a post office. Long queues and slow service were never a problem, as the discussions that took place, were they that long? Entertainment for all. I remember a time when the phone box out the front of the post office malfunctioned and allowed all calls to be made without charge. When Dad discovered the fortunate fault in the system, he didn't advise Telecom, but he did advise anyone he knew who had family overseas. For days afterwards, we had deck chairs and a huge lineup of people outside the phone box. When Dad got a new fax machine, Emma was working in the post office for $1 a day. She asked Dad how much it cost to send a fax. Dad said he just looked out the window at what kind of car they drove and charged accordingly. So, new Mercedes, $3, beaten up Holden, $1. So if you sent a fax in Buninyong between 1982 and 1990 and drove a luxury vehicle, we owe you some money. There are also fond memories around this time of horse rides through the bush surrounding Buninyong. Dad used his racing contacts to acquire a couple of slow racehorses for Siobhan and Matt Lowe. Not many would realise that Tony was riding horses well into his 60s and that he spent his early life as a stable hand back in Ireland.
Dad loved engaging with anyone who showed entrepreneurship. There was the guy in Buninyong with the imported tractors who was also into gold mines, the guy who dispatched maths books from his post office, the sheep fella, assorted builders, and various real estate guys. He was a shrewd and successful property investor. He built and sold a set of four shops in Warren Heath Street, then made a killing by buying them back and moving the post office into them, whereby he could later sell the shops, the post office business, and his home all separately to set up for his retirement. He built the four shops for $19,000 total by a builder called Bernie Boncrete, whose specialty was building structures out of adhesive. Until recently, Dad joked that he couldn't believe they were still standing. Dad actually worked part-time until he was 80 years old at James & Sons, once again with a colourful cast of characters. We think he managed to break nearly every OH&S regulation under the sun during his time at James & Sons, once driving a forklift into a huge tank of water, totally flooding the place. He later lamented at how unfortunate it was that the incident happened during a drought. Tony was always thinking of the farmers. Dad later moved to his small farm at Navigators. He loved working and developing it and running cattle for a number of years. He was in his element out there and proved to himself that the meat market is rigged against the interests of small farmers. He also loved living a simple family life in his cottage at the back of my place over the last few years. We feel very privileged to have had a father who loved us so much and whom we loved in return. It is likely that Tony would be now looking down and thinking that it would have been nice to spend much more time with all of you here, rather than to have to leave unannounced in such a hurry. He'd probably also be thinking he should have picked up a few of those house blocks on the Buninyong Hill when they were going for just $20,000 each. Thank you.
Thanks.
Thanks very much.
I know it doesn't seem that way, but maybe it's the perfect day. Even though the bills are piling, maybe Lady Luck ain't smiling. But if we'd only open our eyes, we'd see the blessings in disguise. Let all the rain clouds are fountains, though our troubles seem like mountains. There's gold in them hills, there's gold in them hills. So don't lose heart, give the day a chance to start. Every now and then life says, where do you think you're going so fast? We're apt to think it cruel, but sometimes it's a case of cruel to be kind. And if we'd get up off our knees, well, then we'd see the forest for the trees, and we'd see the new sun rising over the hills on the horizon. There's gold in them hills, there's gold in them hills. So don't lose faith, give the world a chance to say a word or two, my friend. There's no telling how the day might end. We'll never know until we see there. There's gold in them hills, there's gold in them hills. So don't lose heart, give the day a chance to start. There's gold in them hills, there's gold in them hills.
We prepare now to receive the readings that have been chosen for Tony's funeral mass. If you remain seated, let us pray. God, you are merciful to us all. This afternoon, we pray and thank God for the life that you gave to Tony. As we share these prayers, we thank you for your blessings and goodness that you gave him in this life, and that you now call him to share in the fullness of eternal life. Amen.
A reading from the book of Ecclesiastes. There is an appointed time for everything, and a time for every affair under the heavens. A time to give birth and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to uproot the plant. A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to tear down and a time to build. A time to weep and a time to laugh. A time to mourn and a time to dance. a time to scatter stones and a time to gather them, a time to embrace and a time to be far from embraces, a time to seek and a time to lose, a time to keep and a time to cast away, a time to rend and a time to sow, a time to be silent and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time of war and a time of peace. The word of the Lord. A reading from the second letter of St. Paul to Timothy. My life has already been poured away as a libation, and this has come for me to be gone. The time has come for me to be gone. I have fought the good fight to the end. I have run the race to the finish. I have kept the faith. All there is to come now is the crown of righteousness reserved for me, which is the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on that day, and not only to me, but to all those who have longed for his appearing. The first time I had to present my defense, there was not a single witness to support me. Every one of them deserted me. May they not be held accountable for it, but the Lord stood by me and gave me power, so that they, through me and the whole message, that might be proclaimed for all the pagans to hear. And so I was rescued from the lion's mouth. The Lord will rescue me from all evil attempts on me and bring me safely to his heavenly kingdom. To him be glory forever and ever. Amen. This is the word of the Lord.
If we could stand, please, for the gospel. The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus said to his disciples, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God still and trust in me. There are many rooms in my Father's house. If there were not, I should have told you. I'm going now to prepare you a place. And after I've gone and prepared you a place, I shall return to take you with me, so that where I am, you may be too. You know the way to the place where I'm going." Thomas said, "Lord, we don't know where you're going, so how can we know the way?" Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me." The Gospel of the Lord. So if we could be seated, please. Paddy, I don't normally begin eulogies at funerals with questions, but how many people do you reckon in Ireland will be watching this? Quite a few. So we might sort of do something that's a little bit weird, but say hello to everyone in Ireland. When I was asked would I celebrate Tony's funeral today, I do so as a priest, but also as somebody who from time to time reflects on what it means to live human life, to go through all those various times that we heard about in the book of Ecclesiastes, times of dancing and joy, sadness. I didn't listen properly. Did you say throwing stones and gathering stones back? If you come from Ireland, there's plenty of stones to throw. But life presents so many different phases. And yet, that's how we're meant to live human life. I suppose we just look at one day. And for all of us, we wake up. What's happened, whether we've had a good sleep or a bad sleep, that may impact how the day goes. But the new day unfolds. and different things happen. And because we're human, we've got to adapt and rise to the occasion. Now, some days, probably a bit like the Buninyong post office, it's pretty mundane, things just tick over. And other days, exciting things happen. So when the author of that passage from the Old Testament was writing, they were talking about what it means to be human, to have joys, to have sadness. I don't read much poetry, but when I was in the seminary, a girl gave me a book, and it was, I don't know whether what her intentions were, but it was called This Time Called Life Is Meant to Share. And I suppose that's what we're celebrating this afternoon, is the way in which Tony's life, from its very beginning, back in Ireland, in Wexford, right up until the time of his death here, was shared with other people, most of the time successfully. And then Paul, in the second reading that we listened to, says, well, you can describe life like a race. I follow sport. Tony follows sport. I don't know whether he'd know this, but Ariana Titmus broke her swimming record last night. That doesn't just happen. So that when we say that life is like a race, we're also saying that things sometimes do just happen, but a lot of times they happen because we choose or somebody else chooses, and then we've got to readjust. For Tony, that race, that human race now has come to its conclusion. But as people who believe in Jesus, we say, when death comes upon us, life is changed, not ended. And so that's what we celebrate today. Yes, the human life of Tony is complete, but the spirit of that life and the reality of that life will live with us and forever in eternity. And we take consolation from the gospel passage. Jesus said, do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in me. There is a place prepared for Tony and for each of you. We pray his soul into eternity in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. So I invite now those who are going to share with the prayers of the faithful, the prayers of intercession, if they could come up. I do have a little introductory prayer when I get my microphone back on.
Lord, we remember Tony's devotion to his children and grandchildren, his brothers and sisters in Ireland, and his many nieces and nephews. We also remember Tony's devotion to his friends and give thanks to his special social and walking groups who provided him with friendship and support.
We give thanks to Tony for always coming to watch us play football. We love having you watch a game and talk to us about it afterwards. Thank you for telling us what we did well, not worrying about our mistakes.
We pray for the sick and those that care for them in their time of need. In particular, we pray for Professor George Kanarakis, who cared for Tony for many years. We also pray for the nursing staff at St. John of God Hospital, who cared for him when he was in hospital. May God give them the strength to continue the work.
Dear God, thank you for letting Tony have a long and happy life with all the special people around him.
Lord, we ask you to hear these prayers. We pray for Tony, but we pray for ourselves. May one day we be all reunited in your kingdom through Christ our Lord. Amen. So now we're going to have the offertory procession, and I think we've got music to accompany that, please.
I, the Lord of sea and sky, I have heard my people cry, all who dwell in dark and sin, my hand will save. I am made, the stars are made, the stars of night. I will make the darkness bright. Who will bear?
everything's over there, so that's all set to go. Thank you. Thanks very much.
Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord.
If you lead me.
I, the Lord of snow and rain, I have borne my people's pain. I have wept for love of them. They turn away. I will break their hearts of stone. Give them hearts for love alone. I will speak my word to them. Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you.
I invite you to stand, pray, my brothers and sisters, that our sacrifice may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Be near, O Lord, we pray, to your servant Tony. On his funeral day, we offer you this sacrifice so that he may share in the fullness and the mystery of your presence among us, but now in the glory of your acceptance and love in Christ's kingdom, who is our Lord forever and ever. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him the hope of the blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life has changed, not ended, and when our earthly body lies in death, we gain an everlasting dwelling place in heaven. And so we join with all the angels and the whole company of heaven. We too praise you now as we pray. Holy, holy, holy Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. I invite you to be seated. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and he gave you thanks. He broke the bread and he gave it to each of his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." And together we proclaim the mystery of our faith. We use the first acclamation. We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you hold us worthy to be here in your presence and that we might serve you. Humbly we pray that as we share the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world. Help us to grow in love, together with Francis, our Pope, Paul, our Bishop, and all those who lead us in life and faith. We pray especially today for the repose of the soul of Tony, whom you've called from this world to yourself. We pray for all our family and friends. Welcome them too into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all. We pray together with the Blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, with Joseph, her husband, with Saint Peter and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, that we too may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and that we might praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honour is yours forever and ever. Amen. And so we stand together, we do so with confidence as we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "I leave you peace, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever." The peace of the Lord Jesus be with you always. And I invite you now to turn to those around you to offer a word or a sign of peace. Peace be with you. And I invite this family here to go in front of that camera and wave to the people again in Ireland. Good idea. So you girls might just go in front of that camera there and wave to Ireland.
We can't do that.
You can't do that. We prepare now for communion as we pray. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Grant us peace. This is Jesus Christ, our resurrection and life. Behold the Lamb who takes away the sins of the world, and blessed are you who share in the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed. May the body of Christ bring us to everlasting life. We share now our prayer after communion. God, Tony shared at the table of the Lord while here on earth. We pray now that he shares at your table in the kingdom and rejoices with all those who have gone before him in faith, life, and love. May he share your peace forever as the eternal nourishment, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We come now to the prayers of final commendation, but just before I share those, if you didn't get a booklet, make sure that you join with the family after the burial at Buninyong at the local town hall here. It says you can raise a glass to our town if you want to, but you'd be most welcome to come back there for the wake. We have now our prayers of final commendation and farewell. It is with faith in Jesus Christ that we reverently bring the body of Tony to be buried in its human imperfection. We pray to God, who gives life to all things, that he'll raise up this mortal body to the company of the saints. May God give Tony a merciful judgment and forgive all his sins. May Christ the Good Shepherd lead him safely home. And may he be at peace with God our Father in the eternal kingdom. I think we've got a little bit of music now, Pat, while we incense the coffin.
May the road rise to meet you. May the wind be at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face. May the rain fall softly on your fields, and until we meet again, may you keep safe in the gentle, loving arms of God. For everything there is a season, a time for meeting, a time to say goodbye. In all things, God is near, always guiding your way. May the road rise to meet you. May the wind be at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face. May the rain fall softly on your fields, and until we meet again, may you keep safe in the gentle, loving arms of God.
I invite you now to please stand for our final prayer. God our Father, into your hands we commend our brother Tony. We're confident that with all who have died in Christ, he will be raised to life on the last day and live with Christ forever. We thank you for all the blessings that you gave him in this life, to show your fatherly care for all of us, and the fellowship which is ours with the saints in Jesus Christ. Lord, we ask you to hear the prayers that we've offered this afternoon. Help us to comfort each other with the assurance of our faith, and we all meet in Christ to be with you and with Tony forever. And we pray this through Christ, our Lord. Amen.
deep within my heart I feel voices whispering to me, words that I can't understand, meaning I must clearly hear, calling me to follow close, lest I leave myself behind, calling me to walk into evening shadows one more time. So I leave my boats behind, leave them on familiar shores, set my heart upon the deep, follow you again, my Lord. In my memories I know how you sent familiar rays falling gently on my